castle of Elsinore, Hamlet, Prince of Denmark, mourns the death of the king, his father, and grieves at the marriage of his mother, Queen Gertrude, to his uncle Claudius, who is now king in his father's stead.
Oh, that this too solid flesh would melt, thaw and resolve itself into a dew, or that the everlasting had not fixed his canon against self-slaughter. God, how weary, stale, flat, and unprofitable seem to me all the uses of this world. Fiant. Fie, it is an unweeded garden that grows to seed things rank and gross in nature possess it merely. That it should come to this, but 2 months dead, nay, not so much, not two. So excellent a king that was to this, Hyperion to a satyr, so loving to my mother that he might not beteem the winds of heaven visit her face too roughly. Heaven and earth must I remember. Why, she would hang on him, as if increase of appetite had grown by what it fed on, yet within a month, let me not think on't. Frailty, thy name is woman. A little month, or ere those shoes were old with which she followed my poor father's body like Niobe, all tears, why, she, even she. Oh, God, a beast that wants discourse of reason would have mourned longer, married with mine uncle, my father's brother, but no more like my father than I do. Hercules, within a month ere yet the salt of most unrighteous tears had left the flushing of her galled eyes, she married. Oh, most wicked speed to post with such dexterity to incestuous sheets. It is not, nor it cannot come to good. But break my heart, for I must hold my tongue.
Hail to your lordship.
I am glad to see you well. Horatio, or I do forget myself.
Defame my lord and your poor servant ever.
Sir, my good friend, I'll change that name with you, but what make you from Wittenberg, Horatio? Marcellus.
My good lord.
I am very glad to see you. Bernardo.
My lord.
Good evening, sir.
Lord, I came to see your father's funeral.
Oh, I pray you do not mock me, fellow student. I think it was to see my mother's wedding.
Indeed, my lord, it followed hard apart.
Thrift, thrift, Horatio. The funeral banquet meets to coldly furnish forth the marriage tables. Would I had met my dearest foe in heaven, or ever I had seen that day, Horatio. My father. Methinks I see my father.
Oh, where, my lord?
In my mind's eye.
My lord, I think I saw him yesternight.
So?
My lord, the king, your father.
The king, my father? For God's love, let me hear.
2 nights together had these gentlemen, Marcellus and Bernardo, on their watch in the dead waste and middle of the night, been thus encountered. A figure like your father, armed at point exactly cap-a-pay, appears before them, and with solemn march goes slow and stately by them. Thrice he walked by the repressed and fear-surprised eyes within his truncheon's length, whilst they, distilled almost to jelly with the act of fear, stand dumb and speak not to him. This to me in dreadful secrecy impart they did, and I with them the third night kept the watch, where, as they had delivered, both in time, form of the thing, each word made true and good, the apparition comes. I knew your father. These hands are not more like.
But where was this?
My lord, upon the platform where we watched.
Did you not speak to it?
My lord, I did. But answer made it none. Yet once, methought, it lifted up its head and did address itself to motion like as it would speak. But even then the morning cock crew loud, and at the sound it shrunk in haste away and vanished from our sight.
It is very strange.
As I do live, my honored lord, 'tis true.
Indeed, indeed, sirs, but this troubles me. Hold you the watch tonight?
We do, my lord.
Arm, say you.
Arm, my lord.
From top to toe?
My lord, from head to foot.
Then saw you not his face?
Oh, yes, my lord, he wore his beaver up.
But looked he frowningly?
A countenance more in sorrow than in anger.
Pale or red?
Nay, very pale.
And fixed his eyes upon you?
Most constantly.
His beard was grizzled, no?
It was as I have seen it in his life, a sable silver.
I will watch tonight. Perchance 'twill walk again.
I warrant it will.
If it assume my noble father's person, I'll speak to it, though hell itself should gape and bid me hold my peace. So fare you well upon the platform. 'Twixt 11 and 12 I'll visit you.
Our duty to your honor.
Your love's as mine to you. Farewell. My father's spirit in arms. All is not well. I doubt some foul play. Would that the night were come. Till then, sit still, my soul. Foul deeds will rise, though all the earth o'erwhelm them to men's eyes.
That night, Hamlet, with his friend Horatio, and the soldiers Marcellus and Bernardo, watch upon the battlements of Elsinore. The ghost appears to Hamlet.
Angels and ministers of grace, defend us. Be thou a spirit of health, or goblin damned, bring with thee airs from heaven, or blasts from hell. Be thy intents wicked or charitable, thou comest in such a questionable shape that I will speak with thee. I'll call thee Hamlet, king, father, royal Dane, answer me. Let me not burst in ignorance, but tell why thy canonized bones, her said in death, have burst their cerements. Why the sepulcher wherein we saw thee quietly inurned hath oped his ponderous and marble jaws to cast thee up again. What may this mean that thou, dead corse, again in complete steel, revisits thus the glimpses of the moon, making night hideous, and we, fools of nature, so horridly to shake our disposition with thoughts beyond the reaches of our souls. Say, why is this? Wherefore? What should we do? Mark me. I will. My hour is almost come when I to sulphurous and tormenting flames must render up myself.
Alas, poor ghost.
Pity me not, but lend thy serious hearing to what I shall unfold.
Speak, I am bound to hear.
So art thou to revenge when thou shalt. I am thy father's spirit, doomed for a certain term to walk the night, and for the day confined to fast in fires till the foul crimes done in my days of nature are burnt and purged away. List, list, oh list, if thou didst ever thy father love
a god.
Revenge his foul and most unnatural murder.
Murder?
Murder most foul as in the best it is. But this most foul, strange and unnatural.
Haste me to know it, that I with wings as swift as meditation or the thoughts of love may sweep to my revenge.
I find the act. And duller shouldst thou be than the fat weed that roots itself in ease on leaf of wharf, wouldst thou not stir in this. Now, Hamlet, hear. 'Tis given out that sleeping in my orchard a serpent stung me. So the whole ear of Denmark is by a forged process of my death rankly abused. But know, thou noble youth, the serpent that did sting thy father's life now wears his crown. Oh, my prophetic soul, mine uncle.
Aye, that incestuous, that adulterate beast, with witchcraft of his wit, with traitorous gifts.
Oh, wicked wit and gifts that have the power so to seduce one to his shameful lust, the will of my most seeming virtuous queen. But soft, methinks I scent the morning air. Brief let me be, sleeping within mine watch as my custom always in the afternoon. Upon my secure hour, thy uncle stole with juice of cursed Hebanon in a vial, and in the porches of mine ear did pour the leprous distillment. Thus was I sleeping by a brother's hand, of life, of crown, of queen at once dispatched, cut off even in the blossoms of my sin, unhouseled, disappointed, unannealed, no reckoning made, but sent to my account with all my imperfections on my head.
Oh, horrible, oh, horrible, most horrible.
If thou hast nature in thee, bear it not. Let not the royal bed of Denmark be a couch for luxury and damned incest. Pursuest this act, taint not thy mind, nor let thy soul contrive against thy mother aught. Leave her to heaven, and to those thorns that in her bosom lodge to prick and sting her. Fare thee well at once. The glowworm shows the matted dubinier, and begins to pale his ineffectual fire. Adieu, Hamlet, remember me.
All ye hosts of heaven, earth, what else and shall I couple hell of? Hold, hold my heart, and you, my sinews, grow not instant old, but bear me stiffly up. Remember thee, I, thou poor ghost, whilst memory holds a seat in this distracted globe, remember thee. Yea, by heaven, O most pernicious woman, villain, villain, smiling, damned villain. So, uncle, there you are. Now, to my word, it is adieu, adieu. Remember me. I have sworn.
My lord.
Hamlet.
Hilloho, my lord.
Hilloho, boy. Come, bird, come.
How is it, my noble lord?
What news, my lord?
Oh, wonderful.
Good, my lord, tell it.
No, you'd reveal it.
Not I, my lord, by heaven.
Not I, my lord.
How say you then, would heart of man once think it? But you'll be secret.
Aye, by heaven, my lord.
There's ne'er a villain dwelling in all Denmark, but he's an arrant knave.
There needs no ghost, my lord. Come from the grave to tell us this.
All right, you are in the right. It is an honest ghost that let me tell you. For your desire to know what is between us, or mastered as you may, but now good friends, as you are friends, scholar and soldier, give me one poor request.
What is it, my lord? We will.
Never make known what you have seen tonight.
My lord, we will not.
Nay, but swear it. Never, so help you mercy. How strange or odd soe'er I bear myself, as I perchance hereafter shall think meet to put an antic disposition on, that you at such times seeing me never shall, with arms encumbered thus, or this head shake, or by pronouncing of some doubtful phrase, as well, we know, or we could, and if we would, or if we list to speak, or there be, and if they might, or such ambiguous giving out to note that you know aught of me, this not to do. So grace and mercy at your most need help you swear. Rest, perturbed spirit.
So, gentlemen, with all my love, I do commend me to you, and what so poor a man as Hamlet is may do to express his love and friending to you, God willing, shall not lack. Let us go in together. But still your fingers on your lips, I pray you. The time is out of joint. Oh, cursed spite that ever I was born to set it right. Nay, come, let's go together.
Hamlet, to better observe the king, feigns madness. He has no proof of the king's guilt other than the words of the ghost. But the arrival at Elsinore of a troop of strolling players suggests to him a means of making the king betray himself. He takes the leader of the players aside.
Just hear me, old friend. Can you play the murder of Consago?
Aye, my lord.
We'll have tomorrow night. You could, for a need, study a speech of some dozen or 16 lines which I would set down and insert in, could you not?
Aye, my lord.
Very well. Very well. My good friends, I'll leave you till tonight. You are welcome to Elsinore.
Good, my lord.
I so copy with you. Now I'm alone. Oh, what a rogue and peasant slave am I. Is it not monstrous that this player here, but in a fiction, in a dream of passion, could force his soul so to his own conceit that from her workings all his visage waned? Tears in his eyes, distraction in his aspect, a broken voice, and his whole function suiting with forms to his conceit, and all for nothing, for Hecuba. Oh, what's Hecuba to him, or he to Hecuba, that he should weep for her? What would he do had he the motive and the cue for passion that I have? Why, he would drown the stage with tears and cleave the general ear with horrid speech, make mad the guilty and appall the free, confound the ignorant, and amaze indeed the very faculty of eyes and ears. But I, a dull and muddy metal rascal, peak like John o' Dreams, unpregnant of my cause and can say nothing. No, not for a king upon whose property and most dear life a damned defeat was made. Am I a coward? Who calls me villain, breaks my pate across, plucks off my beard and blows it in my face, tweaks me by the nose, gives me the lie of the throat as deep as to the lungs? Who does me this, huh? Zounds, I should take it. For it cannot be, but I am pigeon-livered and lack gall to make oppression bitter. Or ere this, I should have fatted all the region kites with this slave's awful, bloody, bawdy villain, remorseless, treacherous, lecherous, kindless villain of vengeance. This is most brave, that I, the son of a dear father, murdered, prompted to my revenge by heaven and hell, should like a whore unpack my harp with words and fall a-cursing like a very drab, a scullion violent. About my brain. I have heard that guilty creatures sitting at a play have, by the very cunning of the scene, been struck so to the soul that presently they have proclaimed their malefactions. For murder, though it have no tongue, will speak with most miraculous organ. I'll have these players here play something like the murder of my father before mine uncle. I'll observe his looks. I'll tempt him to the quick. If he but blench, I know my cause. This spirit that I have seen may be the devil, and the devil hath power to assume a pleasing shape, yea, and perchance out of my weakness and my melancholy, as he is very potent with such spirits, abuses me to damn me. I'll have groans more relative than this. The play's the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
king and the queen are much perturbed by Hamlet's apparent madness. But Polonius, the Lord Chamberlain, assures them that it is caused by his unrequited love for Ophelia, who is Polonius's daughter. The king agrees to observe, unseen, a meeting between Hamlet and Ophelia.
Ophelia, walk you here. Gracious, so please you, we will bestow ourselves. Read on this book, Ophelia. That show of such an exercise may color your loneliness. I hear him coming. Let's withdraw, my lord.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing, end them, to die, to sleep. No more, and by a sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to, 'tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die, to sleep, perchance to dream. Aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin? Who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life but that the dread of something the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveller returns puzzles the will and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others that we know not of. Thus conscience doth make cowards of us all, and thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with a pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pith and moment with this regard their currents turn awry and lose the name of action. Soft you now, the fair Ophelia, nymph, in thy orisons be all my sins remembered.
Good, my lord. How does your honor for this many a day?
I humbly thank you well. Well, well.
My lord, I have remembrances of yours that I have long to re-deliver. I pray you now receive them.
Not I. I never gave you aught.
My honored lord, you know right well you did. And with them words of so sweet breath composed as made the things more rich. Their perfume lost, take these again. For to the noble mind rich gifts wax poor when givers prove unkind. There, my lord.
Are you honest?
My lord.
Are you fair?
What means your lordship?
For if you be honest and fair, your honesty should admit no disguise to your beauty. I did love you once.
Indeed, my lord, you made me believe so.
You should not have believed me, for virtue cannot so inoculate our old stock, but we shall relish of it. I loved you not.
I was the more deceived.
Get thee to a nunnery. Why wouldst thou be a breeder of sinners? I am myself indifferent, honest, but yet I could accuse me of such things if a better my mother had not borne me. I am very proud, revengeful, ambitious. What should such fellows as I do crawling between earth and heaven? We are arrant knaves all, believe none of us. Go thy ways to a nunnery. Where's your father?
At home, my lord.
Let the doors be shut upon him, that he may play the fool nowhere but in his own house. Farewell.
Help him, you sweet heavens.
If thou dost marry, I did this plague for thy dowry. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow, thou shalt not escape calumny. Get thee to a nunnery. Go, farewell. Or if thou wilt needs marry, marry a fool. For wise men know well enough what monsters you make of them. To a nunnery go, and quickly to a farewell.
Oh, heavenly powers, restore him.
I've heard of your paintings too well enough. God hath given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jig, you amble, you lisp, and nickname God's creatures, and make your wantonness, your ignorance. Go to, and no more auntie doth made me mad. I say we'll have no more marriages, those that are married already. All but one shall live. The rest shall stay as they are. To a nunnery, go!
Oh, what a noble mind is here o'erthrown, and I of ladies most deject and wretched. Oh, woe is me! To have seen what I have seen, see what I see.
The king and Polonius come from their hiding place.
Love, his affections do not that we tend, nor what he spake, though it lacked form a little, was not like madness. There's something in his soul, or which his melancholy sits on brood, and I do doubt the hatch and the disclose will be some danger. He shall with speed to England for the demand of our neglected tribute. What think you want?
It shall do well, but yet do I believe the origin and commencement of his grief sprung from neglected love. My lord, do as you please, but if you hold it fit, after the play, let his queen mother all alone entreat him to show his grief, and I'll be placed, so please you, in the ear of all their conference. If she find him not, to England send him, or confine him where your wisdom best shall think.
It shall be so. Madness in great ones must not unwatched go.
Hamlet has commanded the players to perform that night before the king. He confides in Horatio.
What ho, Horatio?
Yes, sweet lord, at your service.
Oh, good Horatio, thou art e'en as just a man as e'er my conversation coped with.
Oh, my dear lord.
Nay, do not think I flatter. Give me that man that is not passion's slave, and I will wear him in my heart's core. Yea. In my heart of heart, as I do thee, Horatio. Something too much of this. There is a play tonight before the king. One scene of it comes near the circumstance that I have told thee of my father's death. I prithee, when thou seest that act afoot, even with the very comment of thy soul, observe mine uncle. If his occulted guilt do not itself unkennel in one speech, it is a damned ghost that we have seen, and my imaginations are as foul as Vulcan's stithy. Give him heedful note. They're coming to the play. I must be idle. Get you a place.
The king, the queen, Polonius, Ophelia, and all the court assemble to hear the play. Two players enter dressed as a king and a queen. Hamlet watches Claudius and the play begins.
Full 30 times hath Phoebus' cart gone round Neptune's salt wash and Tellus' orbit ground. Since love our hearts and Hymen did our hands unite commutual in most sacred band.
So many journeys may the sun and moon make us again count o'er, ere long be done.
Faith, I must leave thee, love, and shortly too. My operant powers their functions leave to do, and thou shalt live in this fair world behind, honored, beloved, and haply one as kind for husband shalt thou.
Oh, confound the rest! Such love must needs be treason in my breast. In second husband let me be accursed. None wed the second, but who killed the first.
Wormwood, wormwood.
A second time I kill my husband dead, when second husband kisses me in bed.
I do believe you think what now you speak, but what we do determine, oft we break. So think thou wilt no second husband wed, but die thy thoughts when thy first lord is dead.
Nor earth to me give food, nor heaven light. Sport and repose lock from me day and night. Both here and hence pursue me lasting strife. If once a widow, ever I be wife.
If she should break it now.
'Tis deeply sworn. Sweet, leave me here a while. My spirits grow dull, and fain I would beguile the tedious day with sleep.
Sleep, rock thy brain, and never come mischance between us twain.
Mother, how like you this play?
The lady protests too much, methinks.
Oh, but she'll keep her word.
Have you heard the argument? Is there no offence in it?
No, no, they do but jest. Poison in jest. Huh? No offence of the word.
What do you call the play?
The Mousetrap. And this is one Lucianus, nephew to the king.
What a good chorus, my lord.
Oh, I could interpret between you and your loves if I could see the puppets dallying. Murderer, begin. Pox, leave your damnable faces and begin. The croaking raven doth bellow for revenge.
Thoughts black, hands apt, drugs fit and time agreeing. Confederate season else no creature seeing. Thou mixed your rank of midnight weeds collected with Hecate's ban, thrice blasted, thrice infected. Thy natural magic and dire property on wholesome life, use that immediately.
He poisons him in the garden for his estate. Huh? His name is Gonzago. The story is extant and writ in choice Italian. You shall see anon how the murderer gets the love of Gonzago's wife.
Ah! The king rises.
March, fight him with the false fire.
Where's my lord?
Give over the flame.
Give me some lights. Away.
Stricken deer go weep, the heart ungalled play, for summer's watch and summer's sleep. Thus runs the world away. Oh, good Horatio, I'll take the ghost's word for £1,000, it's perceived.
Very well, my lord.
Upon the talk of the poisoning.
I did very well, my lord.
Why,
my
then?
Lord, my lord, the queen would speak with you, and presently.
My lord Polonius, do you see yonder cloud that's almost in the shape of a camel?
By the mass. And it's like a camel indeed.
Methinks 'tis like a weasel.
It is backed like a weasel.
Or like a whale.
Very like a whale.
Well, I will come to my mother by and by. They fool me to the top of my bent. I will come by and by.
I will say so.
By and by as easily said. Leave me, friends. 'Tis now the very witching time of night when churchyards yawn. And hell itself breathes out contagion to the world. Now could I drink hot blood and do such bitter business as the day would quake to look on. Soft now to my mother. O heart, lose not thy nature. Let not ever the soul of Nero enter this firm bosom. Let me be cruel, not unnatural. I will speak daggers to her, but use none.
In the queen's apartment, Polonius conceals himself to overhear the meeting of Hamlet with his mother.
He will come straight. Pray you be round with him.
I'll warrant you fear me not.
Mother, mother!
Withdraw. I hear him coming.
Mother! How now, mother? What's the matter?
Hamlet,
Thou hast thy father much offended.
Mother, you have my father much offended.
Come, come, you answer with an idle tongue.
Go, go, you question with a wicked tongue.
Why, how now,
What's
Hamlet?
What's the matter now?
Have you forgot me?
Nay, by the rood, not so. You are the queen, your husband's brother's wife. And would it were not so, you are my mother.
Nay, then I'll set those to you that can speak.
Come, come, and sit you down. You shall not budge. You go not till I set you up a glass where you may see the inmost part of you.
What wilt thou do? Thou wilt not murder me! Help! Help! Oh,
oh, help! Help!
Come
help.
Now, a rat dead for a ducat. Dead!
I am slain.
Oh, me, what hast thou done?
Nay, I know not, it's the king.
Oh, what a rash and bloody deed is this.
A bloody deed, almost as bad, good mother, as kill a king and marry with his brother.
As kill a king?
My lady, it was my word. Oh, wretched, rash, intruding fool. Farewell, I took thee for thy bet. Take thy fortune thou finds to be too busy. Is some danger. Leave wringing of your hands. Peace, sit you down and let me wring your heart. For so I shall if it be made of penetrable stuff.
What have I done that thou darest wag thy tongue in noise so rude against me?
Such an act that blurs the grace and blush of modesty, calls virtue hypocrite, takes off the rose from the fair forehead of an innocent love and sets a blister there. Makes marriage vows as false as dice's oaths. Look here upon this picture, and on this, the counterfeit presentment of two brothers. See what a grace was seated on this brow. Hyperion's curls, the front of Jove himself, an eye like Mars to threaten and command, a station like the herald Mercury, new lighted on a heaven-kissing hill. This was your husband. Look you now what follows. Here is your husband, like a mildewed ear, blasting his wholesome brother. Have you eyes? Could you on this fair mountain leave to feed and batten on this moor? Have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age the hady in the blood is tame. It's humble and waits upon the judgment. And what judgment would step from this to this? Oh, shame! Where is thy blush? Rebellious hell, if thou canst mutin in a matron's bones, to flaming youth let virtue be as wax and melt in her own fires.
Oh, Hamlet, speak no more. Thou turn'st mine eyes into my very soul, and there I see such black and granite spots as will not leave their tink.
A murderer and a villain, a slave that is not 20th part the tithe of your precedent lord, a vice of kings, a cutpurse of the empire and the rule, that from a shelf the precious diadem stole and put it in his pocket.
No more!
A king of shreds and patches. And hover over me with your wings. You heavenly guards, what would your gracious figure?
Alas, he's mad.
Do you not come your tardy son to chide? That lapsed in time and passion, let's go by the important acting of your dread command. Oh, say,
do not forget, this visitation is but to whet thy almost blunted purpose. But look, amazement on thy mother sits. Oh, step between her and her fighting soul. Speak to her, Hamlet.
How is it with you, lady?
Alas, how is it with you, that you do bend your eye on vacancy? And with the incorporeal air do hold discourse. Oh, gentle son, upon the heat and flame of thy distemper, sprinkle cool patience. Whereon do you look?
On him, look you, how pale he glares. Do you see nothing there?
Nothing at all. Yet all that is, I see.
Nor did you nothing hear?
No, nothing but ourselves.
Why, look you there, look. Look how it steals away. My father in his habit as he lives. Look where he goes even now out at the portal.
This is the vital image of your brain. This marvelous creation, ecstasy, is very cunning in.
Ecstasy?
My pulse as yours doth temperately keep time and makes as healthful music. This is not madness that I have uttered, O mother. Mother, for love of grace, lay not that flattering unction to your soul that not your trespass but my madness speaks. Confess yourself to heaven, repent what's past, avoid what is to come, and do not spread the compost on the weeds to make them rancor.
Oh, Hamlet, thou hast cleft my heart in twain.
Oh, throw away the worser part of it and live the purer with the other half. Good night. But go not to mine uncle's bed. Assume a virtue if you have it not. Once more, good night. And when you are desirous to be blessed, I'll blessing beg of you. So again, good night. I must be cruel only to be kind. Thus bad begins and worse remains behind. Good night, mother.
King Claudius, now certain that Hamlet suspects him, sends the prince on a mission to England and plans to have him murdered there. Ophelia, distracted by Hamlet's scorn and her father's violent death, loses her reason. Laertes, her brother, returns from France to learn from the king that Hamlet is the cause both of his sister's madness and of the death of his father, Polonius. Then comes the news that Hamlet has evaded the plot to kill him and has also returned to Denmark. Claudius plays upon Laertes' grief for Ophelia and his father's death and persuades him to revenge.
Laertes, now must your conscience my acquittance seal, sith you have heard and with a knowing ear that he which hath your noble father slain pursued my life.
And so have I a noble father lost, a sister driven into desperate terms. But my revenge will come.
Revenge should have no bounds. But good Laertes, Hamlet returned shall know you are come home. We'll set on those shall praise your excellence, bring you in fine together, and wager on your heads. He, being remiss, most generous, and free from all contriving, will not peruse the foils, so that with ease, or a little shuffling, you may choose a sword unbated, and in a pass of practice, requite him for your father.
I will do it, and for that purpose I'll anoint my sword, that if I gall him slightly, it may be death.
I'll have prepared a chalice for the nonce, whereon but sipping, if he by chance escape your venomed stuck, our purpose may hold there. How now, sweet queen?
One woe doth tread upon another's heels, so fast they follow. Your sister's drowned, Laertes.
Drowned?
Drowned. Drowned.
Too much of water hast thou, poor Ophelia. And therefore I forbid my tears. Adieu, my lord. I have a speech of fire that fain would blaze. But that this folly doubts it.
Hamlet, returning to Elsinore, watches unseen the burial of Ophelia. Laertes, distracted by grief, leaps into his sister's grave.
Hold off the earth a while till I've caught her once more in mine arms. Now pile your dust upon the quick and dead, till of this flat a mountain you have made to o'ertop old Pelion, or the skyish head of blue Olympus.
What is he whose grief bears such an emphasis? Whose phrase of sorrow conjures the wandering stars and makes them stand like wonder-wounded hearers. This is I, Hamlet the Dane.
The devil take thy soul!
Thou prayest not well, I pray thee take thy fingers from my throat!
Cut them asunder!
Hamlet!
Be quiet!
Why, I will fight with him upon this theme until mine eyelids will no longer wag!
Oh, my son, what theme?
I loved Ophelia. 40,000 brothers could not with all their quantity of love make up my sum. What wilt thou do for her?
Oh, he's madly at ease.
Forbear him.
Sir Bazoon, show me what thou do. Would weep, would fight, would fast, would tear thyself, would drink up isle, eat a crocodile, I'll do it. Dost thou come here to whine, to outface me with leaping in her grave? Be buried quick with her, and so will I. And if thou pray to mountains, let them throw millions of acres on us. Till our ground, singeing his pate against the burning zone, make our sir like a wart. Nay, and thou mouth, I'll rant as well as thou. Hear me, sir. What is the reason that you use me thus? I loved you ever, but 'tis no matter. Let Hercules himself do what he may. The cat will mew. And dog will have his day.
I pray you, good Horatio, wait upon him. Good Gertrude, set some watch over your son. This grave shall have a living monument. An hour of quiet shortly shall we see. Till then, in patience our proceedings be.
Hamlet, believing Laertes to be reconciled to him, agrees to meet him in friendly combat with the foils. But Horatio is uneasy.
You will lose this wager, my lord.
I do not think so. Since he went into France, I have been in continual practice. I shall win at the odds. But, oh, Horatio, thou wouldst not think how ill all is here about my heart. Oh, it is no matter.
If your mind dislike anything, obey it. I will forestall the repair hither and say you are not fit.
Not a word. We defy augury. There's special providence in the fall of a sparrow. If it be now, 'tis not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now. If it be not now, yet it will come. The readiness is all.
Before the king, the queen, and all the court, Laertes and Hamlet fence. Pierced by Laertes' foil, Hamlet realizes his opponent's treachery. He seizes the poisoned weapon and stabs Laertes. The queen, unknowingly, drinks the deadly cup prepared by the king for Hamlet. And Hamlet kills Claudius, at last avenging his father's murder.
Hear, thou incestuous, murderous, damned Dane! Drink of this potion is thy union here! Follow, my mother!
Oh! He's just preserved, which is a poison tempered by himself.
Heaven make thee free of it, I follow thee. I am dead, Horatio. Wretched queen. And you that look pale and tremble at this chance, that are but mutes or audience to this act, had I but time, as this fell sergeant, death is strict in his arrest. Oh, I could tell you, but let it be. I am dead, Horatio, thou livest. Report me and my cause aright to the unsatisfied.
Never believe it! I am more an antique Roman than a Dane. Here's yet some liquor left.
And on a man, give me the cup. By heaven, I'll have it!
Oh, God, Horatio. What a wounded name. Things standing thus unknown shall live behind me. If thou didst ever hold me in thy heart, absent thee from felicity awhile, and in this harsh world draw thy breath in pain to tell my story. What warlike noise is this?
Young Fortinbras, with conquest come from Poland to the ambassadors of England, gives this warlike volley.
Oh, I die, Horatio. The potent poison quite o'ercrows my spirit. I cannot live to hear the news from England, but I do prophesy the election lights on Fortinbras. He has my dying voice. So tell him with your currents more and less which you have solicited. The rest is silence.
Now cracks a noble heart. Good night, sweet prince, and flights of angels sing thee to thy rest.